Annie Philman.
Hello.
I was horrified to learn that every year more than 900,000 people are victims of dangers in their own homes and need medical care. Home accidents give rise to an estimated 1.3 million days of hospital inpatient care, 2 million outpatient attendances, 0.3 million ambulance journeys, 0.4 million GP consultations, and 7.1 million lost working days. Those are terrifying statistics. Well, today, Tony Wilkins, the editor of the Do It Yourself magazine, is here to help us avoid some of the more obvious pitfalls that cause accidents in the home.
Hello,
Tony. In fact, is that one of the things that happens quite often? People lose their balance on things when they're stretching up?
Yes, the main problem is that they don't lose their balance on that. They lose their balance on things like this, which was never designed for people to climb up on. Mm-hmm. And it has legs which are very close together, and if you're standing on something like this and you're near the edge, before you know where you are, you're on the way to the floor. So accidents do happen very commonly by people climbing up to reach things with the wrong thing that they're climbing on. And this is a typical example. If you want something that you want to climb on and that you're not working too high, then far better use something which is designed for the purpose, like this little stool here.
The point of that is presumably the legs are more spread out.
Yes, you'll see the legs are splayed out here, so that actually the legs are outside the seat area, so that when you stand on it, you get a really good firm. It doesn't take you up very high.
That's quite heavy, actually, and that's solid wood.
It's designed to be heavy too, so that it really is solid on the floor, and it'll give you good support if you're standing on it. So if you want to stand on a stool, then buy a stool which is designed to stand on. Don't use the ordinary kitchen stool which you're going to have your breakfast on.
But obviously, as you say, that is a very low one, and it wouldn't get you up very high.
No, it wouldn't get you very high. If you want to go higher, then invest in a pair of steps like the ones you were using, which have been designed to give you a really safe platform. You see, they're very steady. And
I think the handle I needed.
The handrail is a great boon. I noticed when you moved on there, you grabbed for something, and if that's there, you're okay. The trouble is, particularly with older folk, if they're up a ladder and they feel a bit unsteady, the first thing is they want to hang on to something. There's nothing up there to hang on to. So a rail, especially for older folk, is absolutely essential. And you can get steps with a higher rail than this, so that you've something in front of you to grip. And it really is worthwhile. One hand on the rail, one hand on the job.
And always, of course, be sure that it's right out.
Yes, make sure it's extended fully, and if you're not happy working on steps, then get somebody to hold them for you. There's nothing to be ashamed of in getting some help with the jobs which are rather high, rather than take any risk at all. Many, many people are hurt by taking risks and reaching. Overreaching is another one. If you can't reach something, move the steps and get closer to it.
That's laziness sometimes. You think, well, I've got to get down, then I've got to get up again.
That's it. And you grab hold of whatever's near you. You're in trouble.
Right, from up there, let's go down to the hazards that we can find on floor level here.
Yes, we've rather a messy floor here. I'm hoping this isn't typical of most of our homes, but it is showing some of the areas where we've got things to watch. Starting with water on the floor, yes. A vinyl doesn't seem very slippery when it's dry, but if you spill anything on it, particularly water or cooking oil, something like that, it immediately becomes terribly slippery.
Yeah, so you have to wipe
so that
it
if
up.
You make any mess on the floor, then get it wiped up right away. Don't leave it until some other time, because it really is a hazard. It's very dangerous.
Right, well, that's just one little job done. This rug in front of us here, isn't it frayed? We'll come back to that anyway afterwards, won't we, because that's a hazard. But if you've got a loose piece of carpet on a floor, that can slide very easily and cause accidents.
Yes, I think it's this bit will show you that if somebody was hurrying to the front door or something, that they could very easily slip on this and end up on the floor. So it is essential in areas where a carpet is, or a rug or a runner is on a slippery surface, to anchor it in some way. There are a number of ways of doing that. The simplest is probably to use a netting like this. This is a non-slip netting, and it's designed to go under a slip mat.
It's rubbery, isn't it?
And it is coated in rubber, and as you see, it just doesn't slip at all. So having put that under your carpet, it would stop it moving. It's a very simple way.
Does that
of,
last a long time?
Yes, that will last for years and years, because it's not getting very much wear normally, but it is stopping the thing moving. So a very good investment, particularly say in a hall where you've got a parquet floor with a runner over it to stop the kids getting mud on the parquet. This would be ideal to stop it moving.
And rugs, of course, too, in front of fires, very often move up the side of the fireplace, don't they?
Yes, rugs are another problem. You don't want people tripping over a rug that's near an open fire, for example, even if it has got a guard around it. This put under the rug between the rug and the carpet will sort of give it an anti-creep properties. Mm. It won't move anymore.
That's a foam, so isn't it?
That's a foam, just a simple foam, which goes under the between the two surfaces, and it will stop it moving. Mm. Yet another approach is to use the pads. The idea with this is that
you buy them like that.
Yes, they come in packs. You buy a pack. It costs you about £1 for a pack of about 12, I think it is, something like that. And the idea is that one part of this will go, it's self-adhesive, you've got an adhesive on the back here.
So you take that off and stick that to the floor?
Yeah, you stick one part to the floor, you stick one part to the underside of your carpet or rug or runner, and obviously they're positioned so that they go together. Now when they go together, like so, then they grip. Mm. And although you can pull it apart like this, you won't be able to move it in a sliding action at all. It will absolutely grip the thing firmly.
And you put that around the corners?
Yes, one of these pads at each corner would keep it in place quite adequately. No movement at all. A more drastic way, you can use these little things, which are really press studs. This part goes into the floor. So if you had a parquet floor and you didn't mind making a few holes in it, that part would screw into the floor. That part is sewn to the underside of the carpet, and then it merely goes together like a normal press stud and clicks home, and it will hold the two very, very firmly together.
As you say, that's a more permanent thing, isn't it? Because if you're going to make holes in
the floor... Many people don't like making holes in the floor, in which case it'd be better to use the pads, which could be pulled off and they won't leave any mark at all.
Mm. Good. Now, what about all this rubbish we've got down here?
Yes, we've got a fair mess here, and this really points to the fact that during the winter months, lots of people do work indoors. They ought to be working in the workshop, but it's too cold. If you do work indoors, do clear up the mess as you go. Don't leave it lying around. There are two main reasons for this. One is the fire hazard. If a match or anything
were
dropped into this would burn very, very readily. But perhaps even more important is the fact that the rubbish can be hiding things, which are even more dangerous. And here, we've got a really lethal example of a piece of wood which has come off something. The nails have been left sticking up. And if anybody puts a foot down on there, they will be off work for a long time.
And particularly a rusty one, perhaps.
Particularly. So, A, don't leave pieces of wood on the floor like this. But, B, make a point of drawing them. Take the nails out of a piece of wood. Make a habit of it. If you, however small the nails, take them out as you progress. And there won't be this risk of people stepping on them. Mm. And, of course, never leave rubbish, as we've said, lying around on the floor. Clear it up as you go, and there won't be this risk of a very, very nasty foot accident.
Mm. Toys we've got on the carpet there, which are a familiar sight.
Yes, this another hazard. I look upon it as a particular hazard where, you've got old people in the house. Perhaps the younger ones are a bit nimble, but older folk, somebody coming downstairs and treading onto that skate, for example, would have a very, very nasty accident. Similarly with ropes, where you can get your feet tangled up and so on.
Make the children put them away.
Put them
automatically
away.
When
they don't, do they?
Oh,
but
no.
And it's impossible sometimes to make them. But it is a hazard, which wants watching.
And talking two more of hazards. Yes.
Talking of catching your feet in things, this is absolutely drastic. You know.
So presumably you've just cut those loose parts off because you could easily catch a heel in that.
That would be very dangerous. So this would be cut off with a scissors or knife,
and then
bind the edge with a carpet tape, so that it couldn't happen again. But never, never leave this sort of thing to be dealt with at some other time. People are always intending to do it and just never get around to it until somebody has a serious accident.
The banana skin we've been laughing about, really.
We have. It's so funny, isn't it? I mean, it's one of those typical jokes, but if you've ever met anybody who's slipped on one and spent 6 months on their back with a damaged spine, you find that they're not terribly amused by it somehow. It doesn't strike them as funny as it does us.
Not indeed, no. Over here, Tony, we've got... just a minute before we go. Sorry. Oh, slippers. The shoes and things. Now, these are sort of fairly typical, aren't they, of what people do wear around the house, these mules, which have no support in them at all.
Yes, I was talking to somebody from Rossborough about this, and they say many, many accidents are caused in the home through women wearing the wrong sort of shoes for doing jobs. And they're absolutely dead against this sort of thing. It's been shown that... this sort of shoe gives no support to the foot at all. It comes off very easily, it snags into things, and it really is a danger. So keep them for the bedroom, but if you're doing do-it-yourself jobs or going up ladders or steps, then these are definitely not the things to wear.
Mm.
They're out.
They
you
do actually have proper shoes, don't they, with enforced toe caps?
Well, yes, for hard jobs you can get special shoes, but for normal work, wear a good pair of shoes which give your foot support and don't trip you up.
Over here, Tony, we've got some things that I know we're always saying, if you have, whatever you do, put dangerous things and liquids and poisons out of the reach of children. Now, here we've got a shelf which is fairly high, but there are other points you want to make here, I know.
Yes. This is another very, very common cause of trouble. Things are put into bottles which should never have been put in there. This may be terps, it might be a chemical stripper, it can be all sorts of things, methylated spirits. It was never intended to be put into this sort of bottle, and of course a child doesn't know the difference. A small child won't really realise what's in there, and they know that this is the bottle from which they have a drink in the morning. They will take a drink and again, some very, very serious accidents. So never use this sort of container for putting that sort of thing in. And anyway, any sort of container containing liquids which are dangerous, up on a nice high shelf so the tinies can't even get at them. And even more dangerous than that are containers like this which are in common use in the house, which are used for things which are dangerous. For example, you might be using paint stripper and you put it in here and you're doing the job with a brush and it's put down somewhere. And, of course, when it's put down, the small children won't realise what's in it.
Put on a bench, it looks as though they've, you know, like a breakfast table, doesn't it?
Well,
really,
if they come along now and see those on the table, that's how they are when they have coffee in the morning, and they'll pick one of them up, and before you know where you are, it's empty, and you're rushing down the hospital to see what they can do about it.
Well, these cause some accidents, these things we've got on the table, too. Pretty lethal, some of them, look, I must say.
Yes, we've got some of the things which cause the most trouble.
And we've got also up here the light which shows us that we, whatever we're doing with these lethal things must illustrate it very well, very clearly.
That's a very good point. If you're going to do any sort of work, especially on a bench, then have some light where you can see properly. Normally you can just have something suspended over the bench, but if you find you're working very close to the subject, then you may find that as you bend forward, you throw a shadow over your work. It's probably best to have a table lamp so that it really does throw light onto the subject, and work always so that you're not in your own shadow. This again is when people make mistakes. They're working in a shadow, they can't see what they're doing, and you end up cutting yourself or something. So yes, very, very good point to have good lighting when you're working.